Since 2014, figures show there have been an increased number of assaults on our streets. The vast majority of these occur between Friday and Monday, a weekend glut of physical assaults, violent robberies, and general disregard for the law.
Suspect has been spotted. We're in pursuit.
Our nation's youth are hugely overrepresented when it comes to these violent crimes, with 50% of serious assaults being carried out by people under the age of 30. Youth crime affects everyone in society, but for those it directly touches, it can be devastating. Victims and their families are left to pick up the pieces. But for society at large, the question remains, how best to deal with Ireland's young, dumb, and dangerous?
Small minority of young people who are violent offenders. However, the problem is made appear a lot worse because these young people are repeat offenders. They'll usually do the same thing again and again and again. The recidivism rate for the Irish prison population in general is 62% will commit a crime within 3 years of release. That figure rises significantly when you're talking about the 18 to 24 year old cohort. They also make up a far bigger proportion of those in jail. They make up 9% of the general population, but 20% of the prison population.
For them within their communities, they are conformist. They are not rebellious. We may label them as rebellious, but within their own social milieu, they are perhaps more conformist than we are. They hate the police, they commit crime. That's their normal.
Although in the minority, the presence of such youths can affect whole neighbourhoods as residents are forced to live under the constant threat of their crimes. In October 2010, these fears were realised in Coolock, County Dublin, when Gardaí were informed that a badly injured man had been found lying on the ground in the Newtown Industrial Estate.
There was blood coming out of his ears and parts of his brain had actually come out of his nose.
His injuries left him in a state that it was difficult to identify him, but there was identification on the ground beside him, and that's the way we identified him.
Lukasz Rzeszutko was a 27-year-old Polish man who had come to Ireland to work. He worked with his two brothers in a fish factory in the Newtown Industrial Estate in Coolock in North Dublin.
Lukasz resided in Ireland from 2007. He was a hard-working man, a young man, and was very popular with his colleagues in work.
He'd settled in the Whitehall area of North Dublin. He had a girlfriend. He was highly respected in the fish processing plant that he worked in.
Lukasz was a model employee. He had started on the factory floor, but had worked his way up to supervisor and was due to work in the office that morning. And he almost made it. His body was found just outside the factory gates.
A forensic team searching the industrial estate, which is located between Darndale and the Malahide Road, for clues to what happened here this morning. Gardaí are investigating whether the serious head injuries he received happened during an assault.
Lukasz was brought to Beaumont Hospital, where he was treated for his injuries and he was on a life support machine, but he subsequently pronounced dead at 6:45 p.m. on the 4th of October 2010.
Lukasz died of multiple skull fractures and extensive brain injury, and the pathologist who gave evidence in the trial said that this could have been caused by the blunt force trauma of kicking and stamping in the head.
Kicking a person in the head A number of injuries tend to occur. First of all, we're talking about fractures of the nose, the eye sockets, the upper and lower jaws, teeth knocked out. The kicks cause the head to move backwards and forwards, one side and another. And that movement causes rotational and accelerational type injuries in the brain, a bit like in a road traffic collision. The other problem with that is that blood goes down the air passages and the individual then can't breathe properly and they often inhale blood into their lungs. So kicking to the head is particularly severe and can be particularly nasty and not uncommonly fatal.
CCTV from the industrial estate, which is normally busy in the early hours, is being examined by Gardaí. They're appealing for assistance too from anyone who is around the Malahide Road or the Darndale roundabout. Anyone with information is urged to contact Coolock Garda Station.
A number of persons assisted the guards in this investigation. There was confidential information received. There was witness accounts taken. There was CCTV footage examined. There was examinations done on mobile phone. And all of this evidence pointed in the direction of Stephen Byrne, Edward Byrne and Martin Morgan.
It's the prosecution's case that five people were in that area and that the three accused, Edward Byrne from Cabra Park, his cousin Martin Morgan from Raheny, and Stephen Byrne from Donnymead, participated in a devastating assault on Lukasz Rzeszutko, leading to catastrophic injuries. They were 20, 19 and 17 at the time, and they denied the charge of murder. The court heard that two young girls aged 15 and 16 were with them at the time.
I believe that they were in the company of other youths, and they were drinking in a park close by to Newtown Industrial Estate. And it was sometimes between the hours of 3 a.m. and 4 a.m. that they made their way into Newtown Industrial Estate.
Stephen Byrne told Gardaí that they saw the man coming and that Martin Morgan had come up with the idea of giving him a few slaps, and that Stephen Byrne had just said, why not?
The most important thing about crime and when criminals are choosing a victim, if we can call it that, is that there's simply an opportunity. There's an opportunity to commit crime. There's a vulnerable person on their own. They look weak physically, they look weak mentally. They don't look as if they're going to stand up to the group that are chasing them. So it's the hunting mentality, the preying on this individual.
And that combination of the group, one person trying to outdo the other, is often aggravated and exacerbated by the effects of alcohol. So often the violence that they inflict, often showing off to others in the group, may be greater than perhaps if that individual was on his own.
Martin Morgan and Stephen Byrne approached Lukasz and started to attack him. This sustained attack meant that the victim ended up on the ground.
It was at that stage that Edward Byrne went over. The evidence from the two teenage girls was that he went over to stop the fight, but that when Lukasz kicked or hit him, then that Edward Byrne also joined in and that the victim was screaming while the three of them kicked him. He said that Edward Byrne and Martin Morgan really went to town on him and that Lukasz was fine until Martin Morgan started to stand on his head, and he said that Martin Morgan actually danced on his head.
Jumping and stamping on the head, particularly if it's the side of the head, can cause fractures of the base of the skull, fractures around the eye sockets and around the nose, and that can often increase the pressure with inside the cranial cavity and cause brain tissue to actually be extruded from the nose.
The attack eventually stopped when one of the teenage girls that were with the three men started screaming and encouraging the three attackers to stop, and that's what finally ended it.
Stephen Byrne and Edward Byrne then left the area, but Martin Morgan stayed there, kicking him in the head and stamping on his head for some time.
After the attack, the three attackers and the two teenage girls that were with him went to a local Tesco where they bought some food and some snacks. They were caught on CCTV in the Tesco supermarket, and this later played a major part in the Garda investigation.
As Gardaí questioned the three young suspects, the truly mindless nature of the attack began to emerge.
Stephen Byrne was 17 at the time of this attack. He was from St. Donagh's in Donnymead in North Dublin. He had no previous convictions.
A psychological report was read out in court, and this said that he had limited cognitive abilities and that his thinking abilities were exceeded by 96% of his peers. Stephen Byrne did say that he felt sick when he heard that Lukasz was dead.
He was remorseful in relation to the attack on Lukasz.
But not all of the attackers shared an equally clean record.
Edward Byrne was known to Gardaí. He was a 20-year-old at the time of the killing and from Cabra in North Dublin, although his mother said that he hadn't stayed at home with her for about 2 weeks before the killing and she hadn't seen him. He had 55 previous convictions, including for threatening to kill or cause serious injury to his mother, possession of knives, throwing drugs over the walls of Mountjoy Prison, and he was on bail at the time of the killing and on temporary release from prison. He said that he could have kicked Lukasz in the side of the head and that they stopped kicking only when his girlfriend screamed at them to stop. He said they shouldn't have done it in front of her anyway, and he said they legged it when they saw blood coming from Lukasz's ears.
And the third suspect chose yet another way to react, even when confronted with strong and damning evidence.
It's very hard for us to establish a motive for Martin Morgan because he never admitted his participation in the attack on Lukasz in any way, shape or form.
So he gave no account of his role, but Lukasz's blood was found on his runners and forensic scientists testified that it was in a pattern consistent with stamping or kicking.
Martin Morgan made no expression of remorse to the Gardaí in relation to the assault on Lukasz.
All three attackers eventually pleaded guilty to manslaughter. In the cases of Stephen and Edward Byrne, the Director of Public Prosecutions accepted these pleas.
To commit a murder in Ireland, there needs to be two elements. There needs to be what's known as the actus reus, the guilty act, and then there needs to be the mens rea, the guilty mind. So you must have meant the murder of that particular person. If you did not mean it, it may well fall into the category of manslaughter.
In sentencing terms, the big difference between the two of them is that a person convicted of murder must be sentenced to life imprisonment. There is no discretion whatsoever in that regard. Whereas a person who is convicted of manslaughter is liable to a sentence up to life imprisonment.
The judge told Stephen Byrne and Edward Byrne that they were lucky that the DPP took the view they did. And he said that he would have no difficulty in imposing life sentences on both of them for the manslaughter if he thought the Court of Criminal Appeal would uphold those sentences. Stephen Byrne was sentenced to 9 years in prison for Lukasz's manslaughter. The judge noted that Stephen Byrne had more of an involvement than Edward Byrne, as he was the first to approach the victim. However, he noted that he had a clean record, and that's why he suspended 3 years of the sentence. Edward Byrne, he was sentenced to 12 years in prison.
An aggravating factor was the fact that he was on bail at the time of the offence and that he had 55 previous criminal convictions. However, the Court of Criminal Appeal felt that the judge had not given enough weight to mitigating factors in the case. And Edward Byrne had his sentence reduced from 12 years to 10 years.
Martin Morgan's guilty of manslaughter plea was not accepted by the DPP, and a jury unanimously found him guilty of the murder of Lukasz Rzeszutko. In this case, the judge had no choice but to enforce the mandatory life sentence.
Mr. Justice Barry White said random attacks on innocent citizens cannot be tolerated. Society must be protected, and people must be free to walk the streets at any time, day or night. He also said he was appalled by the callousness of the behaviour of the three after the attack, and that the motive for the killing of Lukasz Rzeszutko was not robbery, but pure gratification.
The nature of this crime and the severity of this crime would not be typical of what would occur in the Coolock area. The Coolock area is a very settled area with a well-established community. It is through the help and the support of the community that an Garda Síochána can thoroughly investigate such attacks as what happened to Lukasz. And we would appeal to the community to keep that help, that support coming.
Coolock and Darndale would traditionally be associated as areas, high crime areas, and a lot of that is due to economic reasons. But it would be untrue to say that Coolock and Darndale have more assaults than any other areas across the capital. For example, in the Temple Bar area in Dublin city centre over the last few months, there's been a number of vicious random attacks.
There are plenty of people in Ireland today who come from underprivileged backgrounds, and that can be, economically speaking, it could be in a familial sense, they didn't get the supports they needed. And doubtless they don't turn out so well in life, they have their own personality problems. But the vast majority of them don't then go on to commit crime. So it can't be used as an excuse, in my view, that simply because you tick those particular boxes, it is inevitable you will commit crime. I think there's so much more going on with those people that we need to address. The early personality issues, how they're behaving as children, and that's where the interventions need to happen.
Random attacks are unfortunately all too frequent in this country on innocent people who are going about their business. Probably the best solution to this is tougher and harder jail sentences.
These people are not incarcerated either at all or for significant periods of time. Rehabilitation must go hand in hand with incarceration, but we have to get the incarceration right first. Every village, town and city in Ireland has what are deemed problem families, problem neighbourhoods. But the families are interesting because they are the metaphor for all that is wrong. They encompass everything. They encompass genetics. They encompass faulty society, parenting, lack of supervision, everything. And they can create havoc within neighbourhoods.
It's quite common to see entire families of people up before the courts for various offences. So it seems to me that violence can nearly infect a family, especially when you've got young males. Violence just becomes the way of life, the way they deal with problems.
The attack and subsequent murder of Lukasz Rzeszutko by a group of three youths was not only notable for its apparent lack of motive, but for the fact that the murderer, who was said to have danced on Lukasz's head, was named Martin Morgan, a name that would have been familiar to Gardaí investigating the crime.
It wasn't just Martin Morgan who was a killer. We find out that he has a brother who has also been convicted of homicide and is in prison.
The Morgan brothers both lived in the Darndale area of North Dublin.
There was a social experiment in England where they built a housing estate with large courtyards in the front, and this was to engender a community spirit, sort of neighbourly feelings or whatever. So they tried to replicate that in Darndale. So low-rise houses surrounding large courts, they were called. However, it quickly became evident that these courts were just venues for antisocial activity, drinking, drugs, joyriding, which kind of led to Darndale having the reputation that it has today.
In areas of Dublin like Darndale and Coolock, it's difficult to know what status symbols might be because money is not plentiful. However, the one thing that unites a lot of people in these areas, young men particularly, is their love of cars, and particularly fast cars.
Paul Manley was a hard-working young man from the Darndale area, loved his family, very into his cars, was the proud owner of a Honda Integra, which he bought for 300 quid, which he seemed very proud of.
He was so anyone could wish for. Hard working. He always looked out for his sisters and me and myself. He was a man of the house. Kept us the family together for that way. Kept us all together. Between 6:30, if he was working late, he'd ring me, "Ma, I'm working late." And we didn't get a phone call, I'd have his dinner in there on the table for him. He'd sit there and the two of us would watch The Weakest Link. And he'd always say, "Ma, would you deal?" I'd say, "No, Paul, no deal." He might arrive, we'd go all the way. And his favourite was his mince. Not sure if it is mince and onions. We haven't always a Paul special.
But one Thursday night in July 2008, a series of events began to unfold that would shatter the Manley's happy family routine.
I can remember my sister Lise got a phone call off her friend saying that his car was getting robbed going up the road. So she came in, she woke Paul up, and Tor and Paul went down to get it.
He found the lads who stole the car, but they chased him away with knives. So he set out again that night to find them, this time armed with a knuckle duster. However, while he was looking for them, Gardaí managed to find Paul first, and he was arrested. So then cut to the next night, Paul again goes out looking for these lads. He's arranged a straightener with them.
Straightener is Dublin parlance for just sorting your differences out. There's an old Queensbury rules feel about it. It's going to be okay. It's going to be man to man or men to men.
Paul Manley is there with his three friends. Two of the friends seem to flee very early on. The fight breaks out. It's Paul and his friend against this group of other young men. At one stage, Paul is retreating. He's trying to get away from the fight. And his friend later told Gardaí that he saw a young man with a hoodie getting up off Paul.
My daughter Lise told me, when I came out, she said, "Ma, I think Paul's in a fight down the road. I think he's getting away in an ambulance." And I says, "He'd be grand. Like, Paul could look after himself." I said, "No, Ma, he's gone in an ambulance." That's when I got up, then I went across the field and I seen them all there, a load of fellas. And I said, "What's that to happen?" And this fella came on up the field and said, "Miss Manley, I didn't touch her son. It wasn't me, it was my brother." And I said, "What are you talking about? You know, what did you do to him?" And then the police came up in the car and they just all ran.
Mr. Manley was alive when he got to the hospital, and he was alive for another 10 days, a period of intense stress for his mother. However, he never woke up again, and he passed away the following week from his wounds.
And the nurse, she called me into the room, she showed me something to ask her. It's not so she really donated his organs. But I said, "Don't touch his heart or his eyes. Leave me down." That gave me a bit of comfort, because I said there's three people out there now. He's not gone, there's three people out there carrying apart from him. He saved three lives.
Investigations revealed that during the tussle, Paul Manley had been stabbed in the head with a screwdriver. The man who was seen getting up off Manley was Mark Morgan.
Mark Morgan claimed he was trying to find a rock, but instead he claimed he came across a screwdriver and used this to stab Paul Manley in the head.
If you're found with a screwdriver, especially if you're a young man in Dublin, you can always say you were doing some DIY work for your mother or that you're working as a labourer in a site. So I suppose from that regard, it's hard for the Gardaí to pin that on you. But as we've seen in so many cases, they can be just as deadly as knives.
So the judge was very sceptical in this case and said he found it disingenuous to imagine that a screwdriver was found at the scene. Nobody could believe that coincidence. It's just not possible.
Morgan had some 65 previous convictions, including once attempting to ram a Garda car off the road. But despite this and the dubious origin of the offending screwdriver, he was sentenced with manslaughter and not murder. He was handed down a prison sentence of 7 years.
He's out now, and we're still suffering. We get the life sentence on him. I don't function the way I used to. You know, I used to go out with my sister once a week, Friday nights, a few drinks, you know, kept in touch, and you know, I've stopped going out with them. I just can't go out and expecting him to be here when I come home all the time. It's too much to deal with, so I stay most of the time.
There was a certain feeling when Mark Morgan and then later his brother Martin Morgan were convicted of these killings that the streets of Dublin would be safer without these two individuals being around, considering the brutal nature of both crimes.
And whether it's screwdrivers or knives, it seems that the use of weapons is now an all too common feature of the criminal landscape.
Very often now knives are carried, and they will be used in the fight routinely, not as a last resort, but as something to even perhaps start a fight. And they will be used in the most haphazard and most violent manner possible.
There was a study of knife crime carried out a couple of years ago which showed that one third of offenders
were under the age of 20. It also showed that 9 out of 10 offenders were male and that 7 out of 10 victims were also male. And the analysis also showed that more than a third of knife crimes took place in a public area.
Since Paul's death, you go, we have nothing but stabbings and deaths out, you know, on all young people. So if you go now carrying a knife or thingy, you're looking for trouble.
On a night out, if a fight develops, people will reach for the nearest sharp instrument. The language is now cutting people up. It's the complete evisceration of the victim, which wasn't so evident 10, 20, 30 years ago. That's the difference in 2016.
While the proportion of knife-wielding youths may be small, the effect their actions have on the rest of society can be huge. This was clearly demonstrated in the murder of 19-year-old David Byrne Hayes.
David, from a young age, got into terrible devilment. You know, there was a time when David was 7, and he went to the local shop up the road and he bought himself a bus pass and got on the bus and he travelled all around the city of Dublin on the bus and had everybody up the wall that day wondering where he was.
He's a messer. He always had a good smile on him. And but the best thing I found out about him was every time he looked at me or ring me, he says, "How am I fixed?" I said, "What do you want now? I need this and I need that and the whole lot." So I said, "That's the only time you taught me so many more money." He said, "That's the reason why you're there for." And I got a laugh at him.
David was 6'1". You know, I used to be sliding him saying, you know, see him all meeting a butcher's apron. David, and he'd be up in the bedroom with his headphones on and he'd have his weights going. And David loved himself, really did. If there was a hair astray on David, you know, it was just major bedlam. Nobody could get into the bathroom where David was. He was just, he just loved himself. David loved life, you know, and always saw the best in everybody.
David was always somebody that had a smile. You know, he'd always say hello to you. You know, even at a time when he wouldn't have been sort of attending here, he'd sort of, little bit sort of grown out of here. You know, he'd still drop in the odd time. He'd always say hello to you on the street. And I know even looking back at, say, photographs that we'd have from, say, when he was younger, you know, you'll always see David there with sort of a big smile on his face and just somebody pleasant, you know.
Him and Anne were always side by side. For a mother and son, they were just inseparable. When David then came into his teens, Anne was diagnosed with lung cancer. And that was very tough for David because he was only a boy. He was just coming up to his 18th birthday. And I remember Anne writing a letter. She'd been through so much chemo and radium. And she wrote a letter to God. She was pleading with God to spare her.
Dave. While David obviously needed his mother, she also came to rely on him. At 18, David became his mother's full-time carer, alongside a training course where he was learning to work professionally as a carer for the disabled.
Well, I saw huge potential in a young man like this. He'd gone from, it was just an initial introduction to disability services, to actually having a keen interest in his future in it. How he interacted with not only the staff, but also the service users, showed a huge empathy and an interest that showed love for and compassion for what he did and what he would have done, you know?
David was clearly an asset to society. There's not many men of his age involved in caring for a parent and then also involved in training to be a carer. So David had it all. He had it all in terms of a life course.
He knew his mom's time was coming. He wanted her to see him for who he was, who David was becoming at the time. And I had promised him that morning that he was going to have a long time with his mum, but unfortunately that night he didn't.
The scene in Dublin where a 19-year-old man was attacked last night. The victim was discovered in the car park of the Emmett Court apartment complex in Inchicore. He was taken to St. James's Hospital, where he was pronounced dead before midnight. Gardaí say they believe four youths chased the man before he was stabbed several times. They are appealing for witnesses.
As part of the investigation, David's phone was recovered from his clothing, and it would have been examined by a mobile phone analyst.
Gardaí recovered about 30 text messages from David's phone from that night. The first one was sent to a number saved in his phone as Sinead S, asking if she was coming out to meet him that night. Shortly after that, he received a text from an unsaved number saying that this was Sinead, that her phone had died, and then a meeting was arranged. So David Byrne thought he was meeting a girl called Sinead on the night that he was killed.
The fatal stabbing of 19-year-old David Byrne Hayes on March 19, 2011 was a double blow for his family. The tragic loss of David's life was worsened by the fact that he had been his terminally ill mother's full-time carer. Gardaí investigations recovered a text conversation from David's phone in which he appeared to be arranging to meet with a girl called Sinead on the night he was killed.
It was obvious from the text messages that he thought he knew who he was talking to. There were, I suppose, friendly text messages. There was hon, there was smiley faces, there was XXX. It wasn't someone that he didn't know, or that he thought he didn't know. It was obvious that he was texting a girl.
One of the text messages he sent that night to the person he thought was Sinead said that he couldn't go near the Shore Road that night because he was fighting with the boys.
Which would indicate that he has had some sort of an argument or a falling out with somebody in the recent past.
He never gave us any vibes because he was in good form. He was in happy form that evening. He was just a little down because his mum was so ill.
There were then a number of text messages between David and this phone about where they would meet. David suggested the canal, but the user of the other phone suggested a youth centre in the area known as the Bosco, and David Byrne agreed to this. There were then a number of text messages between the phones just updating each other on their whereabouts until 22:11, when a text message was sent from David's phone which said, "I'm there," and a number of kisses.
There's no sense of fairness in what happens subsequently. David goes along and is met with four people. Four people against one. It's very difficult for us to understand that. We see it as cowardice. The perpetrators don't. They see it as a pack chasing a prey, almost hunting this person.
Investigations led Gardaí to retrieve CCTV footage from the St. John Bosco Youth Centre.
We spent the whole day going through the footage on the cameras, and some of the footage that would have been started to use would have related to people hiding before David came along and hiding in sort of gardens next to the centre. You would have seen David coming across from the Lewis tracks, walking across the road. When he got up past a couple of the houses, that's when you see a lot of movement in the gardens and people coming, sort of running out at him. And David just straight away sort of turns and goes running across, heads across the road. He goes across the Lewis tracks, up over the bridge, over the canal. And then sort of that's where we sort of, the footage finishes from our cameras. I suppose what sticks with you is, you know, that sense of obviously, sheer panic and fear. And I suppose there was a palpable sense of that in the footage, that you could feel it yourself sort of watching it, that just that sense of sheer panic that would have taken hold of him,
The foot chase was obviously quite frightening for David. It was a lengthy foot chase. It began outside the John Bosco U Club. It crossed David Road, crossed the Lewis Lines, up a footbridge over the Grand Canal into Dublin 8. It progressed along Vincent Street West into the Emmett Court apartment complex. It was quite a lengthy foot chase. It certainly would have been 800 or 900 metres in length. On the footage, when David enters the apartment complex, you can see he's out of breath. You can see he's obviously suffering from his exertions of trying to evade his attackers.
One of the residents of the apartment complex was driving in the gates that night, and he saw the victim being chased, and he saw a person catching up with him and digging him in the back. He didn't see a knife, but he did say it was dark. He said he thought it was just a digging. They chased him into a dead end in the Emmett Court complex. There was a wall there, and a witness gave evidence that the victim seemed to be trying to climb over the wall, but it was too high, and he said that he had nowhere to go.
We obtained the CCTV footage from the Emmett Court apartment complex. The footage captures David Byrne running in the apartment complex entrance. He goes off camera. He's followed by a youth in a grey hoodie. There was also three other youths there. The youth in the grey hoodie goes off camera for 26 seconds, during which stage David suffers the fatal wounds. As this youth in the grey hoodie walks back out of the apartment complex, he turns sideways and a side profile of his face is captured.
Footage also showed David Byrne staggering into shot after the attack and collapsing onto the ground. David had multiple stab wounds to his back. Both his lungs and his heart were punctured, and the fatal wound was 20 centimetres deep.
A number of witnesses attended to David at the scene. Someone said he's already been stabbed. He appeared to be trying to speak. He appeared to be saying that he was having trouble breathing. Certainly there was a lot of blood. He had blood in his face and he had blood in his back.
When the paramedics arrived, David was still breathing, but he stopped breathing within 20 or 30 seconds of their arrival, and he was rushed by ambulance to St. James's Hospital, but he died later that night.
I heard it all about him. Then I heard the banging on the window, whole lot, and I said, "That's him again." He said, "He's after losing his key." And as I went down into the hallway, I roared him and said, "David, leave it out, I'm on my way into you." And then I heard, "It's not David, it's the police." I said, "Now what did he do?" And when they opened the door, they came into the hallway and just says, "We want you to come down to James's Hospital to identify your son." And that's when I seen him lying there. Couldn't get near him. Couldn't do that.
And we weren't allowed to touch him. But that didn't stop her. She took a hold of him in her arms.
While the family struggled to cope with the shock, Gardaí were on the hunt for suspects.
This morning, the first four teenagers were arrested in Drimna. Two of them are 14-year-old boys being detained for withholding information. This afternoon, three more teenagers were arrested, two youths and a girl. This is a crime which involved young people, and Gardaí say they know there are a number of other young people who have information or were at the scene that night who have yet to come forward. They're urging them now to do so. Among those in custody tonight is also the young man who's believed to have stabbed David Byrne.
A local community-based Garda in Sundry Road Garda Station, Garda Pat Culhan, was able to identify the youth in the grey hoodie from the side profile as Marcus Kerwin. He was 17 years of age at the time, and he resided with his mother in Drimna. He was known to Garda, and he had a number of previous convictions for drugs-type offences.
There was also CCTV footage from a chipper in Drimna where Marcus Kerwin went after the killing. At that stage, blood was pointed out to him on his hoodie, and it showed him going outside and taking off his hoodie and returning inside wearing a rugby top. And that's the top he was wearing when arrested a couple of days later.
He would have been interviewed in relation to the murder of David Byrne. While being interviewed, he stated he was innocent and that he wasn't involved in it.
Marcus Kerwin was picked out of an identification parade. A resident of the apartment complex was called to Kevin Street Garda station sometime after the killing and asked if she recognised the person who had chased David Byrne that night. And she picked out number 16, and this was Marcus Kerwin.
The positive identification of Marcus Kerwin offered little solace to David's family, however. They and the community at large struggled to come to terms with what had happened.
There was a shrine set up over at the murder scene, with candles and different mementos, and there was a flag and stuff like that. And I know, you know, there was quite a number of sort of his friends and people that knew him sort of gathering over there, certainly for at least a week, you know, after the killing, you know.
Everything was a big commotion for them 2 weeks, you know. We got through his funeral, and it was Mother's Day the following day. I never spoke. Anne shut down. She never spoke to any of us. And we were trying to organise to have the local priest to come to the hospice to do David's Month's Minds Mass. But Anne took a turn for the worst in the early hours of that morning. And she passed away at 20 past three that morning. She died on the day of his month's months. And I firmly believe he came and took her.
Marcus Kerwin went on trial at the Central Criminal Court in 2013. Charged with David Byrne's murder, he pleaded not guilty and denied all involvement.
The trial was horrific.
Members of David Byrne's family actually left the courtroom in tears when the footage was shown of David being chased.
When they seen the chasing and the running and all that, that was the hardest. Then the other thing, just saying when he's left on his own.
Just times I do put my hands to heaven and thank God that God did take her, that she wasn't here to witness that.
A jury found Marcus Kerwin guilty of murder by unanimous verdict. There were gasps in the courtroom as the verdict was read out, but Marcus Kerwin showed no reaction as he was led away to begin his life sentence.
The family of murder victim David Byrne leaving the Central Criminal Court this afternoon following the verdict, which they said has given them faith in the justice system.
He cared for his mum who had cancer. And he was just a lovely boy. He never done anything wrong on anybody.
I just wish him, he's happy up there now, looking down on his arse.
It's closure now.
And I hope all this nonsense of killing will stop for everybody's sake.
Having killed at 17, while still a child in law, the 19-year-old showed no emotion today as he was led away to begin a life sentence in prison. Marcus Kerwin's father left the court this afternoon saying there was always such a thing as an appeal.
This young man who accepts no responsibility is actually more typical than we might imagine. Remember, for him, the reference point is not the criminal justice system as we understand it. The reference point is within his own community. So for him to plead not guilty, for him to appeal, is completely normal within his world. We might look at the criminal justice system as something he should adhere to and stop appealing when he's being caught, but for him it's something to be used and indeed abused, and we must never forget that.
Marcus Kerwin's appeal was heard in July 2015, but in October that year, the Court of Criminal Appeal dismissed it on all grounds.
Common sense prevailed there at the end of the day. Justice was done for us, and that person that took David's life will spend the rest of his life in a prison cell.
In reflecting, you know, back on, you know, when I think about the events, you know, that occurred that night, I suppose the thing that strikes me most is, you know, the loss of potential, you know, the fact that, you know, there was David, you know, huge potential for his future life. You know, he was doing a new training course. You know, he had a whole life ahead of him. God knows what, you know, what things he would have done and the life he would have had.
But for 4 weeks, we lost two very special people in horrible circumstances. And there's times we do try to console ourselves and say, yes, they are together. They're together in heaven. I want them in heaven. We want to be with us.
He's resting in peace now. You know, he's happy where he is now and that, so. Well, I'm happy now for him, you know. I don't know where he is. You know, I just talk to him all the time. I talk to him all the time now, and he talks back to me.
Violent crimes committed by youth offenders in recent years are certainly worrying. And it's no surprise that their gruesome details and the devastation they leave behind only help to feed the popular concept of a feral youth.
The term feral youth, it's often used, and understandably used, to describe these young lads. However, it is a negative term. It's something that we associate with wild animals who maybe need to be put down. Sir, you're dehumanising the problem, which, you know, for someone who's been the victim of a violent crime, you can absolutely relate to, but it's not getting to the heart of the problem. It's just dismissing it as the actions of wild animals.
When a person commits a crime, it's not just the person they've committed the violent crime again. That young person is responsible for ruining that life, ruining their family's life, ruining their neighbourhood's life, bringing down the area as it used to be known. And it does. It affects all our psyche, our attitude to each other. We view each other with suspicion. We're nervous. We become antisocial ourselves. It affects us all. Society is a victim of this crime. It's not just the individual. And until we get that into our heads when we're down the pub on a Friday night talking about how terrible a crime is, we're never going to have a resolution to it.